My name is Joshua Grochow. I'm an Omidyar Fellow at the Santa Fe Institute. And it's my great pleasure and honor to introduce tonight's speaker. Before I get to that, I'd like to thank Thornburg Investment Management for providing funding for this lecture series and allowing us to bring in great speakers like Steve. So let's have a round of applause for them. Steve Strogatz started in math at Princeton as an undergraduate, then went on to a PhD in applied math at Harvard. He taught at MIT for 5 years and then got a faculty position at Cornell, where today he is the Jacob Gould Schurman Professor of Applied Math. His time in Boston was actually very important for me personally. During that time, he wrote a paper on synchronization of biological oscillators like fireflies and heart cells, which about a decade later would be the first academic paper that I ever read. So it's a lot of fun for me to be introducing him tonight. He's described himself as an applied mathematician, but unlike so many in our field, he strives to maintain close collaborations with experimentalists, which keeps his research grounded and actually applicable. He's received numerous awards for his research, teaching, and public service, of which I'll mention just a few that stood out to me. He's a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and a fellow of the Society for Industrial and Applied Mathematics. He's received many teaching prizes from Harvard, MIT, and Cornell, including MIT's highest prize for undergraduate teaching. He was invited by the University of Cambridge to give their annual Rouse Ball Lecture in 2009, which is quite an honor. Previous Rouse Ball lecturers, including the likes of Einstein, Dirac, Pauli, Mandelbrot, Lorenz, and a number of Nobel laureates and field medalists. He's one of the truly great science and mathematics expositors of our time. He's been recognized as such by a number of awards, including the Communications Award, which is given jointly by the four major American mathematical societies and is a lifetime achievement award for the communication of mathematics to the general public. He's also received the AAAS Public Engagement with Science Award, whose previous winners include such luminaries as Carl Sagan, Neil deGrasse Tyson, and E.O. Wilson. He's written two weekly blog series for the New York Times, in which he successfully shared the joy and beauty of mathematics with the general public. And to give a flavor of just how successful these series were, the Harvard Business Review described them as must-reads for entrepreneurs and executives, not something you often hear about mathematics expositions, and a model for how mathematics needs to be popularized. He's spoken at TED and appeared frequently on NPR's Radiolab and Science Friday programs. He filmed a series of 24 lectures on chaos for the Teaching Company's Great Courses series and is the author of 4 books, a now standard textbook on nonlinear dynamics and chaos, 2 popular books on synchronization and the calculus of friendship, and his most recent book, The Joy of X, has been translated into 15 languages. Tonight, he's going to tell us about some successes and challenges in communicating math to the broader public. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming Professor Steven Strogatz.
Wow, thank you for that nice introduction, Josh. And thanks to the Santa Fe Institute for inviting me. It feels great to be back in Santa Fe. I love coming here. It's actually the first time for my kids to come here. And unlike you, they had the sense not to come to this lecture. But I do appreciate all of you turning out on this beautiful summer night. So our topic is the communication of math to the public. Yes, the joy of X. Some of you will recognize the little pun in that title. You'll recognize it refers to the joy of cooking. Actually, not quite, but... Anyway, so let me begin by telling you a little story about this. It was almost exactly 5 years ago today. I can remember the day well. It was August 13th, 2009. And the reason I can remember it is it was my 50th birthday. I was asked by the op-ed page editor of the New York Times, David Shipley, to come meet him for lunch in New York City. And I didn't really know why, but he said he had a proposition for me. And so I was curious, and he didn't know it was my 50th birthday. That was just a coincidence. But anyway, I showed up, met him in Grand Central Station at a place called the Oyster Bar. And maybe some of you know it. Some East Coast people will know, yeah. He actually said, meet me at the saloon in the oyster bar, which I, okay, so I so I met him, and then he said, would you ever have time to write a series about math for my readers? And I was really shocked at this, because I you know, you never see math in the newspaper, really. And the idea that there would be a series of articles about math in the New York Times was a surreal proposition. And I said, it sounds very interesting. And you know, as it turned out, I would have time, because the way my teaching schedule was that year, I had taught all my courses, or I was scheduled to teach all my courses in the fall. And I knew that I would have the spring semester without any teaching obligations. And so I thought I could do it in the spring if he was interested. That'd be the spring of 2010. He said, yes, he's interested. What would a series look like, he asked me. And of course, I had only thought about it for 20 seconds at that point. So I said something like, well, and I knew this trick that op-eds are supposed to be about something in the news. You may have noticed this, right? If you read the opinion page, that they're usually, you're expressing some opinion about a current event. And so I said, there's always math in the news. I could think about like the hidden math of, at that time, the people were talking a lot about the financial crisis or about climate change. Or he said, no, you don't understand. That's way too sophisticated. Let me explain what I have in mind. I'm talking about, I want you to write about math for my readers of the opinion page. This is not the Science Times. This is the opinion page. These are people who studied humanities in college. Then he went on to tell me a story about how he was an English major in college, and he had taken math in high school like anybody else. He said he'd even gone all the way up to calculus, and he had gotten decent grades in math all through high school, but he never saw the point. Like, what was this for? And he knew that he'd never used it the rest of his life, so it couldn't be for that. And so why was he made to do that? And why do we ask people to take so much math? You know, could I write about that? And also, he also said that he felt left out, that sometimes people say math is beautiful or math is elegant, and he doesn't know what that means. And he suspects that many of his readers similarly feel left out and don't know what that means, and probably don't really believe it, that it's beautiful. How is it beautiful? Just adding numbers, what is that? So I said, yeah, I could write something about that. But he said, yeah, so not about climate change and the economy. I want you to start, your first column will be about numbers. Your second column will be about addition. Next column will be about subtraction. And he said, now do you understand what I'm talking about? I think you should start in preschool with the idea of numbers. Like, why are they important? What do we need them for? How are they helpful? What's mysterious about them? Make it interesting. You know, but at a level that a four-year-old would understand. And then he said you could get more sophisticated as you go through, you know, like you could go into first grade, second grade, and then and go as far as you want. So I thought that sounded wonderful, because, you know, any math professor, that'd be our dream, that we can just grind our way through the curriculum in the logical way, through algebra and geometry and calculus, and then eventually into graduate school topics. He said that, okay, you know, that might be a little too much, graduate school and math, but go as far as you can go, and that sounds interesting, so go ahead and try it. And so then this became a reality. In the spring of 2010, I did write 15 columns for the paper, which were not published in the print newspaper. They were published in the online version of the New York Times on the web, which at the time I felt like, ooh, that's kind of a second-class piece of real estate. But in retrospect, it was actually better to be on the web, because you could do things in that medium, like I could show videos or computer simulations, or I could link to interesting stuff on YouTube, or, you know, there were just many more things you could do on the web. Also, there was no length requirement, because there's no space problem on the web. You can be as long-winded as you need to be. So these were longer than a normal op-ed. Anyway, so yes, 15 columns, and then later I wrote 15 more that were not in the newspaper, but that became The Joy of X, this book that Josh mentioned. So tonight what I'd like to tell you about is some of these adventures of trying to bring math to the masses, and some things I learned about what worked and didn't work, because, you know, Who knows how to do this? I mean, I might ask you. By the way, I'd like this to be interactive. I don't like just pontificating. Oh, I mean, I do like some amount of pontificating, but I would also like to ask you some questions and possibly have you give some answers. One thing I guess I would want to say, though, is that if I ask a math question, you know, like if you're a genius at Los Alamos who's come down for the talk, that's not really, I'm not really asking you. I know you know the answer. So if you're a little kid or if you're someone who always hated math and somehow inadvertently ended up at this talk tonight, that's who I really want to talk to. I'm happy you Los Alamos and SFI people are here, but give the other people a chance to respond. Okay, so anyway, let's begin. So one technique that I, as you can already tell, I like to try to make this fun, and it seemed to me that if I could get the audience in the newspaper laughing a little bit about some of the playful aspects of math or the fun of it, possibly showing people the fun for the first time, that maybe I'd win some of them over. And so let me give you an example of that. This was an example that was in one of the very earliest columns about the mysterious world of decimals. So think about this. If you have kids who have gone to school, or maybe you are such a person yourself, you may be learning about decimals yourself right now, they are one of the first really tricky ideas, right? I mean, most people can figure out how to add 2 plus 2 and subtraction. Okay, subtraction starts to get a little tricky with carrying and borrowing. Actually, I guess carrying would be with addition. Borrowing is with subtraction. But that's already a little bit delicate. But then once you get to division, it really gets confusing because you can write numbers as fractions, and then you have to learn to also write them, you know, as decimals. And many people start flying off the rails at that point and never really recover. And I want to give you an instance of this through this demonstration. This is an actual phone call I'm going to show you because it's the transcript will appear on the screen, that a frustrated customer of Verizon decided to post on YouTube. That is, this customer, as you'll see, was being charged a rate for his data plan that was 100 times more expensive than what he was told. That's a significant amount of money. He was told a certain rate, and he was happy to pay that rate, but in fact, when his bill came, it was 100 times more than that. And so he called to complain, and I'm now going to play you the clip from his conversation. And you'll see that it boils down to a question about understanding decimals. So, as I say, this customer was quoted a data usage rate. It turns out he was quoted 0.002 cents per kilobyte. And he thought that sounded like a pretty good deal. But he was charged $0.002 per kilobyte. And so listen to what ensued. By the way, this clip ultimately made it to the top 50 on YouTube's comedy channel. So let's see if I can get this to run. George Vaccaro is the name of the frustrated customer. So thank you, George, for posting this.
Looks like you're questioning some kilobyte usage that was done while in Canada, $0.002.
Do you recognize that there's actually...
0.002 cents.
Yes. Do you recognize there's a difference between those two numbers?
No. $0.002 and $0.002 cents.
Yes. Is there a difference between...
They're both the same if you look at them on paper-wise.
No, they're not, actually.
So if you take 0.002...
cents, remember, it's cents.
Times 35,896 is $71.79.
No, that would be 71 cents. How much should I be charged?
By the way this is calculated, $71.79. You're paying 0.2 of a penny per kilobyte.
Hold on. 0.2 of a penny would be 0.2 cents. You quoted me 0.002 cents. So which is the real rate?
0.002, sir.
0.002 what?
Cents per kilobyte.
So you just said it was 0.2 pennies. And then you also said it's 0.002 cents. Those are two completely different numbers. They're 100-fold different.
Okay, George, hold on 1 second for me, okay?
All right, now comes the expert.
This is Andrew. I'm a manager on the floor. How can I help you today?
Hi. Do you recognize that there's a difference between $1 and 1 cent?
Definitely.
Do you recognize there's a difference between half a dollar and half a cent?
Definitely.
Then do you therefore recognize there's a difference between $0.002 and $0.002?
No.
I'm teaching math here.
And I mean, I'm trying to get what you're saying here, but it's just not...
And we're talking about cents, right?
Right, .002. And if we multiply that by the amount of kilobyte usage that you have...
35893.
35893, that comes out to what you paid, 71.79.
Cents. You never did the conversion from cents to dollars.
I don't know, I'm not a mathematician.
.002 cents. Times my 35,893 is a number, but it's still in cents.
We're not quoting $0.002. We're quoting $0.002.
Oh, God. Honestly.
Well, I mean, it's obviously a difference of opinion.
It's not opinion. Okay, well, you know what? I'm going to post this recording on my blog.
And that's what you want to do. That's fine.
That's what I'm going to do. And then you guys all at Verizon can learn.
Yes. Okay. So you can check, if you're interested in this, I mean, it goes on. It's a long, you can find the whole transcript on George Vaccaro's webpage. Or you can find it, Verizon Math Fail on YouTube if you want to hear it again. But, yeah, so if you think about this, okay, I mean, we had a good time with that. But it's a little bit risky from a teaching standpoint to be laughing at the people at Verizon, because some of you in the audience may have also been confused about this notion of 0.002 cents. If you're not used to thinking, that's a hard thing to think about. You've never held that in your hand, so it's an abstraction of a kind. What does it mean? And also, if you followed the difficulty that the people at Verizon were having, it's because of what your teachers have told you about units. Right, that the units are important. You need to know, are you talking in cents? That is it cents per kilobyte or dollars per kilobyte? It makes a difference. And a good teacher will teach you to keep the units in the calculation and then to cancel the units in a certain way. So then if those people had known that, they would have realized they were quoting him an amount in cents. Okay, but anyway, the part that's dangerous, I think, from a standpoint of pedagogy is that nobody likes to be laughed at. And, you know, it's an experience that a lot of us have had in math, that someone laughed at us for not understanding something. And so I want to move now to this next topic that I think is important in trying to communicate math with the public, and also, you know, to all of you who are teachers out there. I'm guessing there are probably some teachers who have come tonight. That it's very important to have empathy with the student or the listener. That is, and sympathy is one thing, but I actually mean just literally empathy. Try to get into the mind of the person who's confused. It would be interesting to understand, like, how would you explain better to those people at Verizon so they would get it? Because George somehow couldn't get his message. Now, of course, maybe the people at Verizon are taught to do it wrong, if you want to be cynical, because it did turn out 100-fold to their advantage to be wrong in that way. Okay, leaving that aside, assuming that they were honest, we should think about how to communicate better. And so I think it's a useful technique in teaching to try to share confusion, that is, empathize with the students' or the listener's confusion, the reader's confusion, and then work together to get past it. And so I want to give you an example of that now, which for me was a very personal one, in that my uncle Irving, who was my dad's brother, liked math, and he used to ask me little puzzles when I was a kid. And one of them sticks in my memory because I was very embarrassed at getting it wrong at the time, and he laughed at me, like the way we were laughing at the poor people there from Verizon, the customer service reps. So Uncle Irv's question to me was one of these classic word problems that you might remember from algebra, or if you haven't taken algebra, you will soon be encountering these because we still ask them. And it's a question about a peculiar kind of bathtub that you would never encounter in the real world, but you will in algebra class. So there it is. There's a bathtub, and it's got this funny property that the faucets don't pour in water at the same rate. Can you see that water is gushing out of the faucet on the left and kind of just drip, drip, dripping out of the faucet on the right? So I'm trying to convey here that imagine a bathtub where the cold water faucet, the one on the left, if it were running by itself, it could fill up the tub in half an hour, says Uncle Irving to me. Imagine a tub, the cold water could fill up the tub in half an hour. The hot water, which runs slower, if it were running by itself, would take a whole hour to fill up the tub. Okay, you're with me? One takes an hour, the other takes a half hour. Suppose they both run at the same time, how long to fill up the tub? That was his question to me. I was maybe 10 years old. And now, can you guess what wrong answer I gave? Hold on, let's not chatter that. There's a youngish looking person with both hands pointing to himself. Please, what did I guess that was wrong? 45 minutes. Were some of you thinking that? That's an interesting, and you may have thought that was the right answer. That's okay if you thought that, because I did too back then. why would someone think 45 minutes? Continue, please. Yeah, right. So the reasoning given is one takes an hour, 60 minutes. The other takes a half hour, 30 minutes. If you figured somehow that it's correct to look at the average of those two, because, I don't know, okay, that's the wrong thought, but suppose you just thought that, like I did, you'd say 45 minutes, and then you'd have the experience I had of your uncle laughing hysterically at you and searing the memory in your head for the rest of your life, which is in a way a good thing because it gives me an opportunity to talk about it now. There's another answer that's wrong that you will commonly hear if you're confused. Can someone think of an even worse wrong answer? Yes, please, good, another young person. An hour and 30 minutes, beautiful, thank you. Because then you would add the two numbers, right? One takes an hour, one takes 30 minutes, so an hour and 30 minutes running together. Can you see that that's a pretty foolish answer? Because after all, running on its own, one of them would take 30 minutes. How could it possibly take longer if the other one is helping? Right, so both 45 and an hour and a half are nonsense. The answer has to be something less than 30 minutes, clearly, right? So what is it supposed to be? Now, at this point, some of you probably have already figured out the answer, and there are many ways of figuring out the answer. Let me tell you, well, I don't know, how should we do it? Should I tell you Uncle Irving's solution, or would someone like to volunteer a solution? Might be interesting to let you go first. A grown-up wants to answer. Are you a math type? You're not answering. Yes? No? You're not a math type. Okay, so what do you think? Oh, this is a good answer. Somewhere between 18 and 20 minutes. I like it. Thank you. You're a brave person. Good for you. That's strictly speaking true. I mean, you gave yourself a little bit of a window there, a little cushion. But you're right. How did you get that? You have good common sense or something. You didn't do it with math, did you? Well, it takes an hour. 30 minutes for one, the other takes an hour. Yeah, so she says one, it takes a half hour, the other one's helping, should be something less than a half hour, give or take 18 to 20 minutes. Very good. That's good. Did someone have a little more precise answer? Oh, yes, please. Oh, yes, how old are you? 10, good. You're a better 10-year-old than I was, I can tell. Let me have it. Yes, you did it with fractions. Go ahead. Oh, So our lecture is being live. I'm sorry. Our lecture is being live broadcast here on YouTube. And so for people who are watching and may not have been able to hear that answer, let me try to summarize it. The 10-year-old gentleman in the back says, he's now curling into his chair. You should be proud. You gave a good answer. He says, let's think about how much of the tub each one would fill in 10 minutes. One of them would fill a third of the tub. The other would fill a sixth of the tub. And putting those together, a third plus a sixth, is that's 2/6 plus 1/6. That's 3/6. That's a half. You would fill half the tub in 10 minutes, therefore the whole tub in 20 minutes, which is consistent with your answer. And that's the right answer, 20 minutes to fill the tub. Now, very well done. Good for you. Now, Uncle Irving's answer to me was very similar. He said, think about how much they would each fill in 1 minute. Same idea, though, instead of 10 minutes. He said, in 1 minute, one would fill a 30th, one would fill a 60th. Adding them together, it's 3/60ths. That's 1/20th. So they fill a 20th of the tub in a minute, so 20 minutes for the whole tub. Okay, so that's right. Yes, do you have a comment? Aha. Now here's a very elegant solution from this gentleman, who I'm wondering, are you a math teacher? Just a smart guy sitting in the audience, okay. just a person who's got a big smile. So his solution is very clever. Now, the traditional textbook way is like what Uncle Irving told me, with how much does each fill in a minute or 10 minutes like our solution was given earlier. But this clever way that you just suggested is you could think about in 1 hour how many bathtubs get filled. This is a really nice, if you don't know what I mean by elegance in math, here's an example of elegance. That is, just say in 1 hour, one of them fills one bathtub. We already said it takes an hour to fill the tub with the slow one, the hot water faucet. The other one fills a bathtub in half an hour, so two bathtubs per hour, and running together, 2 + 1 = 3 bathtubs per hour. That's one bathtub every 20 minutes. So that doesn't use any fractions. That's just a very quick, intuitive way to do it. And I've tried to sketch that here in this sort of surreal picture in which I'm showing. You see, what's confusing about the problem, here's the empathy part of it. Why is the problem confusing? If you were confused, like I was, it's because you're trying to visualize the hot water and the cold water, and they're sloshing around, and it's confusing because one is coming in faster, and then you kind of want to give up, and I don't like math, and okay. So here's a way of trying to re-visualize it so that you don't have the confusion of the hot and the cold mixing together. You just say, pretend there are these conveyor belts with bathtubs going past, and there's a cold water faucet that's just filling as many tubs as it can fill, and there's a hot water faucet filling as many tubs as it can. Don't worry about where the bathtubs go after they get to the end of the conveyor belt, where just it's a math imagination here. This is not engineering. So anyway, that's another way of kind of imagining 3 bathtubs per hour. Other solutions that people have given to me, did anyone else have a different way? Maybe I should just move on, but sometimes you get interesting stuff. Did anyone have another way of getting to 20 minutes? You have another way?
Yes.
Oh, okay, well, good. Because there's often a lot of right ways to do a problem. Do you mind if I cut you off? Because I think you're giving this sort of, you're giving the right answer, but it still sounds like it's 3 bathtubs per hour, so it's somehow different in your mind?
I can't remember how I did, but I got to 20 minutes and 10 minutes.
C was 2x. He's saying C was 2x and H was 1x? Jeez. Okay, if I can summarize, thank you. It sounds like this is a way of doing it with algebra, with letters, for unknowns, which will work. And so you concluded, I mean, what you're saying is, if I'm getting you, that the one that runs faster is filling up twice as much of the tub as the one that runs slower. So in the same amount of time, one will fill two-thirds of the tub and the other will fill one-third of the tub. And how long does it take for the slow one to fill one-third of the tub? 20 minutes. That if that's the reasoning, that's another nice way of doing it. All right, maybe enough with the bathtub. Okay, so let's leave that. Anyway, part of the message here was, you know, to show the creativity in math. For people who think that there's a wrong and a right in math and that math is authoritarian and rigid and boring because, you know, there's a right way to do it, baloney. That's wrong. If anyone taught you that, that's wrong. Math is full of creativity, and I think you've seen it here in the audience, all the different ways of reasoning, from common sense to, you know, fractions to all kinds of creative ways of getting to this, even in this simple, relatively simple problem. Okay, so empathizing was message two. Now, another message, this is in terms of trying to convince people that math is fun or worth, that is, the ones who don't already get it, that it's worth looking at or taking a second shot at for the grown-ups like David Shipley's readers at the Times. I felt like if I could give people an aha moment, then they would have a mathematical experience. They would see what it is that makes those of us who love math love it. That's the thing. I mean, anyone who gets it knows the feeling of exhilaration and satisfaction from finally seeing the right way of thinking about a problem, an illuminating way. So now, actually, my wife, who is not mathematically, you know, I mean, she's an artist who doesn't, it took math but doesn't really like it or doesn't think of herself as a math person. She was extremely helpful. When I would write columns, she would read them and then say, "This is boring because you're just teaching me." And that wasn't what she wanted. She said, "I want insight. I want a moment of illumination." So that was always the test. If she felt that she was illuminated or suddenly got something, then I was on the right track. So here, to me, this is one of the cleanest and most convincing examples of a moment of illumination. I hope it will work for some of you. It has to do with a formula that you learned in some point in your education, the area for a circle. Some people have probably memorized it, some may remember it. If the circle has a radius r, so just to remind you, here's a circle, round. It's got a circumference, that's the distance all the way around. The diameter, the distance across through the middle. And then half of that distance is what we call the radius, the distance from the center out to the circle. So the formula, you'll remember, is pi r squared, right? The radius squared times this amazing number pi is the area shown in green, the area of the circle. And so the question is why? Why is that the right formula? And, you know, my kids who are now 12 and 14 were taught that formula in school, and they were not really taught why it's true. Just, this is the formula, and then do 50 standardized test problems about this. And it's not a good way to help people love math. And so I want to show you this really marvelous proof that the area of a circle is pi r squared, which is an ancient proof, thousands of years old, known to the Greeks, known around the world. There are woodblock carvings of it in Japan that shows that it was known in that part of the world. So different parts of the world discovered this, and if you haven't seen it, you're in for a treat. So look at this proof. Before I get to the proof, though, maybe I should say, what is pi? Right, we talked about pi. I said pi r squared, but what's pi? Pi, for this purpose of this proof, is defined as the ratio of the circumference to the diameter. Okay, if I take the distance around the circle divided by this distance across, that ratio is the number we're calling pi. Which, as you know, is around 3.14 dot, dot, dot. If you're a very sophisticated person, you might be thinking, how do I know it's the same for all circles? Is pi the same for a little circle or a big circle? If you're asking that question, you're too sophisticated for my purposes here. And you can probably answer the question for yourself. If not, I can tell you later. But let's just suppose it's the same for all circles. It is. Anyway, so pi r squared, what's the proof? Well, what I like about the proof I'm going to show you is it has the flavor of drama. That is, in the theater, it's often good to get your hero in trouble. And then, you know, the plot thickens and it it gets worse and worse for the hero, and then eventually there's a breakthrough, and then there's the resolution, and actually I guess there's a climax and a resolution. All right. So first we're going to start getting our hero in trouble. The strategy is we're going to take this circle and chop it into these four equal pieces shown there in color, and then rearrange them in the way shown at the bottom. And the strategy of the proof is, if I can figure out the area of that weird shape on the bottom, then I will know the area of the circle, because it's the same four pieces, right? So the area of the thing on the bottom that looks like some kind of garden slug is the same as the area of the circle. And two things I want to point out about this shape on the bottom is that you can see I've marked here that it has a length on the bottom, which I've written as pi r. Why is that? Well, because remember that this whole circumference of the circle was pi times the diameter, which in terms of the radius would be pi times 2 times the radius. 2 pi r is the circumference of a circle, and half of that is now appearing on the bottom. So there's pi r, that length on the bottom, the other pi r is on the top, and then r, the radius, is just this piece here, so I'm showing that r. Okay, so that's all I know about that shape, and it looks like we're in trouble because we've made the problem harder. That is, how am I going to figure out the area of this thing? That looks worse than that nice round circle. So that's the plot thickening. It looks like I've done a stupid thing. I made my problem worse. However, it becomes better when you do this thing. You say, actually, four pieces was my problem. What if I took more pieces? Okay, so now I've made eight pieces, and I've rearranged them in a similar way. And do you notice some things about that new shape? For instance, I've indicated too that its bottom length is still pi r, and the length on the side is still r. You might say, well, so what? I don't see how that's helping. But let me compare this. Like, you know, when you go to the optometrist, they give you this little test where they say better, worse, better, worse, better, worse, better, worse. So, oh, okay. So which one do you like, better or better? Better? This one is better. Do you agree this is better? Or better? With 16? Now, why is that better? It's better because this part is getting flatter. And this part, which said R, notice what's happening. It's still R, but look at the way it's tilted. Used to be like that, and it used to be like that. Okay, so look, it's standing more straight up each time. Now you're starting, hopefully you're getting a little bit of spine tingling feeling, or like maybe your hair is sticking up a little, because you're about to see a beautiful mathematical moment, which is you're having a thought, right? I went from 4 to 8 to 16. Do you see where I'm going? What do I want to do? I want to keep going. In fact, I want to do infinitely many pieces. Now that comes as a surprise to some people, because infinity, you know, you're taught is this mind-boggling thing and paradoxes, and it's in philosophy courses, and actually people used to get burned at the stake, Giordano Bruno, for thinking about infinity. So infinity has all kinds of religious, theological dimensions to it. Only God is infinite. Okay, but leaving that aside and hoping no thunderbolts come down to us, let us take the leap and think what would happen if we kept going and took the limit of infinitely many infinitesimally thin pie slices. Can you see what the limiting shape would be? Right? Can you see that it's going to be that? It seems plausible. It's not exactly a proof. If you're a very rigorous mathematician, you would make a little fuss at this point, but get out of here. And so any reasonable person, I mean, it's true, there's a little bit of finesse required, but leaving that aside too, the limiting shape can be proven to be this nice shape, which has a bottom which is still pi r, just like all these others had pi r on the bottom, and whose side is r. And now we know the area of that shape. That's a rectangle. So it's pi r times r. That's pi r squared. That's the reason. That's good, isn't it? Yes. So I like that for all the dramatic elements in it, the use of infinity to the rescue, the making a problem worse before it gets better, the no algebra. I mean, you're just drawing a picture. So people who are visual, right-brain thinkers should like this. Anyway, it's a great proof. It, as I say, it's been around for thousands of years. And some teachers out there, if, I don't know, there may be some teachers who still teach it. I congratulate you if you're doing that, because I think it's really a very clear demonstration, and a beautiful one. So this is the pleasure of math. But one aspect of the pleasure is to see these arguments, the reasoning, that it's not just memorizing formulas or doing 50 problems for standardized tests. It's about beautiful reasoning and thinking. Now, that's not all math is. There's also this question that always comes up, what's it good for? How is it relevant to me in my everyday life? Or, well, that's a good question. I care about that a lot. As an applied mathematician, I'm interested in how math connects to our real lives. Excuse me?
A lot of bathtubs.
Well, yeah, not exactly real everyday life, but idealized everyday life. So in writing these columns, I did often, whenever I could, try to connect some concept to some place in the real world where it comes up. So, you know, also my philosophy of teaching was that I don't really know what's going to work. That is, some people say, you've got to tell it through history. People like people. They want stories about people. That's good. I do include people. Some people like philosophy. I try to connect to philosophy. Some want current events. Some like sports. So I'm just kind of agnostic about that. I figure if I push every button I can, I might accidentally push your button. Okay? Art, anything. I don't know. So here's some examples of math in everyday life. There's one. There's Michael Jordan hanging in the air. And I used him to illustrate an idea from calculus, which is that at the top of his jump, you know, they talk about it looks like he's hanging. He's got amazing hang time. Well, what does that mean? That when someone jumps up, at the top of their jump, at that instant, they're not moving up or down. They're hanging. And that's literally true. Their vertical velocity is zero at the top. They're not going up or down. They're not moving at the top. And more generally, in calculus, when something reaches a maximum, if it's a smooth maximum, this concept we call the derivative will be zero at the peak. And so this is an example. This sensation of him hanging in the air momentarily is equivalent to what we're teaching students when we teach the idea of, you know, derivative being zero at the maximum. So for some people, that kind of thing works. But you could still say, Michael Jordan, good as he was, it's not really that important. This is just sports. Give me something that's important about math, where I really care. And so at the risk of being a little bit grim, let me give you the next example, which is a somewhat unfamiliar thing, at least to many people, a concept called conditional probability and Bayes' rule. And I want to show you how it's relevant to this very vexing problem of mammogram screening for women. So imagine this scenario. Actually, this comes from a study that was done by a psychologist, Gerd Gigerenzer, in Germany, who was interested in the training of doctors who are oncologists are confronted with this kind of issue, you know, what to advise a woman based on the results of her tests, her mammogram tests. And so this is from Gigerenzer's book, Calculated Risks. I just want to read it with you. It's a lot of words here, but let's try to get the idea. Here's a question he posed to doctors. These are numbers that are reasonable numbers. The probability, let me back up for 1 second. He gives the doctors a hypothetical scenario. He says, you've met a woman, she's your patient, who is in a low-risk group. She's 40 years old. Her family has no history of breast cancer. She has no symptoms. And she comes to you for a mammogram test, and it comes back positive, which is, of course, terrifying. So what do you tell her? How worried should she be? And what should be done? So keep that in mind. Low risk, no prior history in the family, and unfortunately the test is positive. So now you need to know the numbers of various things. And so these are the numbers that the doctors were told. The probability that one of these women, that is, we're imagining a hypothetical cohort of many such women, not just the one patient, but other women in her situation with the same profile. The probability that one of these women actually has breast cancer is, we're told, 0.8%. If the woman actually has breast cancer, the probability is 90% that she will have a positive mammogram. If the woman does not have breast cancer, the probability is 7% that she will still have a positive mammogram. Do you understand that last point? That is, even if she doesn't have it, 7 times out of 100, the test will say she does. Those are called false positives. That can happen. But it doesn't happen that much. 7% of the time it will happen. But by the way, the other number, 90%, is the number that it will be caught when it's there, right? That is, 10% of the time it will be missed, but 90% when she has it, it will say that she has it. Okay, anyway, it's all very confusing. If you're confused, that's good. That's how you're supposed to feel. Now, imagine that a woman has a positive mammogram. What's the probability she actually has breast cancer? That was the question posed to the doctors. Still with me? It's confusing, right? So, hard to think about. If you haven't been trained in conditional probability, you may not have any idea what to say. And now, let me tell you the results of the study that Gigerenzer did, where he actually asked doctors this question. He did the first study in Germany, then similar study was done in the United States. So he asked 24 German doctors. Their estimates range from 1 to 90% probability that the woman actually has breast cancer. That's pretty scary, isn't it? I mean, imagine you want a second opinion. One says 90% chance we've got to do something, and the other says it's not a serious problem, it's only a 1% chance. 8 of the doctors thought the chances were only 10% or less. 8 more said 90%, and the remaining were somewhere in between, 50 to 80%. And don't think it's something about German doctors. When the same thing was done with American doctors, 95 out of 100 of them thought it was around 75% chance. Okay, so now, what's the real answer? 9% chance. That is relatively good odds. You know, considering it's a positive test, the odds are still only about 1 out of 11, 9% that it actually is positive. So let's discuss, first, why is that original version so confusing, and how could we teach doctors in a way that helps them get the right answer? You would agree, this is pretty practical math. And so let me show you, because it's actually a very easy problem if you're taught how to think about it the right way. The reason it was hard, do you want to tell me? What was so hard about, I mean, there's many things confusing, but what was so hard about it the first way that I told it to you? Do you have a feeling? You may not be able to answer this. Or what was confusing about it to you?
There's 3 different numbers.
Yes. There's 3 different numbers to look at.
Yeah,
and it's hard to keep track of the 3 different numbers. It's like an equation with 3 unknowns. Even though you were told the numbers, you don't know what to do with them. Sort of like the bathtub problem, but much worse. Am I supposed to average them, or what do I do with them? And so what you're supposed to do with them is this thing called Bayes' rule. Now, I can tell you that I never really studied probability theory, and so when I am called on to teach it, which that kind of, you know, that happens in college, it's always a little bit terrifying for me, because I don't know what I'm doing. And so when I used to teach it out of the book using Bayes' rule, I noticed that a lot of my students weren't doing the problems using Bayes' rule. They were doing it some other way, and they would get the right answer. And I couldn't really understand what they were doing. And at first I was tempted to mark them wrong, except that their answer was right. And I don't want to be one of those teachers who said, you didn't do it by the right method, because that's not how it works in math. There are often many right methods. And as I started to understand better what they were doing, I realized that my students had a better way of thinking about this than I was taught, than the book was teaching me. And so here's how the students were doing it, and here's how Gigerenzer independently discovered how to tell doctors a way to do these problems so that they will get the right answer. Here's the same problem recast, not with probabilities, but with actual numbers. So watch. I give you the same information, but I use what Gigerenzer calls natural frequencies. Remember we said that the chances were 0.8% that this cohort of women would actually have breast cancer? Say it with numbers. Imagine 1,000 women. 8 of them have breast cancer. That you can understand. Now, I told you that 90% of the time that breast cancer would be caught by the test. So out of the 8, multiply now by 90%, or 0.9, 7.2 of them will have a positive mammogram. Just to keep the numbers simple, let's round it to 7. Okay, so out of the 8 that actually have it, 7 will come up positive. Do you follow that? And out of those 7 who are tested positive, well, what about the other women? There were 992 who don't have breast cancer. Now, we were told that the false positive rate was about 7%. So that means out of 1,000 women, 70 would test positive. So rounding again, pretending that 992 is 1,000, 70 will turn up positive incorrectly. Now, that means 7 tested positive for real and 70 tested positive falsely. So now, imagine a sample of women who test positive. How many of them actually have breast cancer? Do you get that it's 7 out of 77? That's 1 out of 11, that's 9%. That's what I said, right? It's 9%. And it's because of all these false positives and because it's relatively rare for women in this low-risk group to actually have it. What's really happening is that the test is just incorrectly saying that. So, but the details of this are not as important as recognizing that the way you think about the problem can make it much harder or much easier. As soon as you make it numbers instead of percentages, the problem sort of structures itself. And actually, those of you who understand Bayes' rule will realize that what we've done here is the proof of Bayes' rule. I'm not doing anything different. This is Bayes' rule. And that's why Bayes' rule makes sense, because this is how you do it. But we're just doing it in a way that the logic sort of shows itself in the way the problem is set up. Do you want to ask anything? I realize that was the hardest. That's probably the hardest one we're going to do tonight. But you get it? So anyway, that was supposed to make the point that the math is relevant to the real world. And so I, in my column about probability, I used this example and an even grimmer one, which was the probability that was important, one of the many probabilities relevant to the O.J. Simpson trial. Some of you will remember this. This is now 20 years ago that O.J. Simpson, I don't want to go into the details, it's sort of too horrific, but the question was, you know, what are the odds that he did it based on certain evidence? The evidence in question being that he had a history of beating his wife, Nicole, before he allegedly murdered her. So just on that basis alone, and using Bayes' rule, you can show that the odds were 90% that he did it. Leaving aside DNA evidence, bloody footprint evidence, but also leaving aside the evidence that the Los Angeles police might have framed him, might have planted the bloody glove. So I'm not saying whether he did it or not, although I do have an opinion, as you might also. But if you want to read the details, you can read that in that column. Okay, so anyway, that's a little bit of conditional probability. And let's see, when should I, that's 8:23. I'm almost ready to stop. I have one more thing I could do, but I'd like to have some questions and discussion too. You want me to stop and we'll talk? Want me to do one more? One more? I can do one more. This is the only, I guess I will, but let me say what this one. This is a negative example in that I've told you some things that I think work. Just to summarize, right? We said a little sense of humor, some relevance, some aha moment. And I think I said one more, but like that Texas governor, I can't remember. What was the other one? Oh, yeah, empathy. Yeah, empathy. I knew there was a fourth one, said Rick Perry. So, okay, but the fifth thing is something that didn't work. So I want to show you something I learned that did not really work. And I wouldn't do it again. Can I think about the problem this way? That, you know, math is hard for a couple of reasons. For people in the audience, it can be hard because it's abstract. You hear that word used a lot. Abstract versus concrete. Concrete, like it's something you could hold in your hand, you can really picture it or think about it. It's real, it's palpable, versus abstract, it's some ethereal thing. So you can have concrete versus abstract. That's one way to make things harder or easier. There's also another way, which is you can make things be very familiar, like, oh, I've worked with that before, or very unfamiliar. And so just to tell you what I mean, like when I just did this example with breast cancer and Bayes' rule, I'm guessing that for many people that math was unfamiliar. Not all of you, but for some of you, you never thought about a problem like this before. Yet it was concrete, about something very real world and tangible. So although the problem was unfamiliar and therefore difficult, it wasn't the ultimate in difficulty because it was concrete, and so you could think about it. On the other hand, when I did the circle problem with the pi r squared, that was abstract in the sense that it looked like a math problem from school about the area of a circle, but it's very familiar. Everybody did that 100 times in their life. So even though the circle, and you seem to enjoy the circle, so even though it was abstract because it was familiar, I could get away with it, and because it had the good aha moment. Well, one time I tried to do something that was both abstract and unfamiliar, and I think that's too hard. But I thought I could get away with it because of visualization. I thought because of the medium, if I could show a really cool video, even though it was at both abstract and unfamiliar, maybe the audience would still like it. And my wife, Carol, said, don't do it. It's really bad what you want to do. And I said, no, there's this really cool video that a math colleague, so I was asking people when I was writing these columns, you know, on each one, I'd have to write one for the next week, and there's a deadline, and I don't know what I'm going to do next. I didn't have it all planned out. And I asked people for advice, and one colleague gave me this interesting advice. He said, do you know this certain video that shows the shortest path on a two-holed torus? And I thought, oh, I really like this. And so I showed Carol the video, and she said, don't say torus. So I said, what's wrong with torus? She said, no one knows what a torus is. You could say a tire, or you could say a donut, or a bagel. Don't say torus, because that's jargon, math jargon. And I don't really care about the shortest path on a two-holed torus. I don't know why do I care about that? And she said, but there's this great video. Let me show you the video. And she watched it. She said, it's a horrible video. That's not good. Don't do it. But I said, no, trust me. I know what I'm doing. So I want to show you that now. That is, I thought by, you know, visualizing and making abstractions tangible. Just to tell you what I had in mind, I had previously done a column about about geometry of the type we all learn in school, which is Euclidean geometry. I was doing something about the Pythagorean theorem. Okay, so everyone's heard about the Pythagorean theorem, and I tried to explain it a few different ways. So that's traditional flat space geometry in the plane. But then it seemed like people ought to learn about non-Euclidean geometry, geometry on curved surfaces. So I didn't think it was that tough. First, I could do this problem. What's the shortest path between New York and Rome, let's say? You know, I mean, we've had this experience. If you've taken a flight, you know that thinking about the shortest path, it's not always obvious what it will look like on the globe. That is, New York and Rome, it's a nice little geography question. Which is farther north? My dad used to ask me this question, because you'd assume Rome is farther south because of the weather being so nice in Rome. But actually, if you look on the globe or look on Google or whatever for the latitude of Rome and New York, they're basically at the same latitude. And if anything, I think Rome may be a little bit farther north than New York, but not much. And so let's approximately say Rome is due east of New York, yet the pilot, if you've ever flown there, doesn't fly along a line of latitude. The pilot does not fly east. The pilot does this flight going up over Nova Scotia and hugging the coast of Canada. Now, the first time I ever did that, I thought, it's for safety. You know, like if something happens, one of the engines, you see why I'm not an engineer. if one of the engines gets in trouble, we'll be near Halifax and we'll be okay. But that's not the reason. If you take a globe and just hold it up and look at where New York is and look at where Rome is and, you know, sort of tilt the globe and look what's the shortest path on the surface of the Earth, it's this path, like I'm showing, that hugs the coast of Canada and then goes just south of Ireland and into Rome like that. Okay, so that's the shortest path on the surface of the Earth. It's the thing that mathematicians call the arc of a great circle. It's what you would get if you put a plane through the Earth going through the center. That's the analog of a straight line on a globe. Okay, so what I'm saying is you were taught the shortest distance between two points is a straight line. Yes, on a flat space. On a globe, it's not a straight line. It's a thing like this, an arc of a great circle. And so where I wanted to take the readers is, what's the analog of a straight line on a weird space like a two-hole torus? Just to get the idea that there are generalizations of the straight line. So here's the amazing video. I built it around this video by Conrad Poltier. So now you can watch it yourself and see what you think. Let's see if this will work. I may have to jump out of PowerPoint for a second. Yeah, that's not going to work. Thank you, Bill. That's Bill Gates. Okay. No, let's do it this way. It would work if I did it right. It's my own fault. Okay. So check it out. Sorry, I have to interrupt your viewing pleasure for 1 second. Let me set it up a little bit. What you're going to see is this shape, which looks like a sort of a pretzel-y shape. It's got the two, it's sort of like if you took two donuts and welded them together. That's the two-holed torus. And now you'll see that there's a motorcycle there, but it has no rider. You might wonder why not. Good question. Because this rider, this bike, is supposed to show us what straight lines would look like on this surface. And the way it's going to do it is, imagine I had a motorcycle with the handlebars locked in position so that they're not turned. They're just, the wheel is always pointing straight ahead. Okay, I'm not going to curve. I'm just going to go straight ahead, as straight as I can go, except I have to stay on the surface. That's the idea of how we're going to trace out a straight line on a curved surface. We're just going to lock the handlebars to go straight ahead at all times, and just follow the lay of the land and see where that takes us. On a plane, that would take you in a straight line. On a sphere, that would take you on an arc of a great circle. And now we're going to see what this, you know, riderless, locked handlebar motorcycle will do on a two-hole torus. And you'll see that a straight line is very weird on a two-hole torus. Well, all right, so now, oh, some clapping, thank you. Well, I'm glad that worked for some of you, though one thing that happens when you write for the newspaper in the online version of the newspaper is that there are comments. Yeah, so readers weigh in with their opinion, and one reader, I didn't read the comments by and large because I'm very sensitive. And, you know, people say mean things on the web. You probably noticed that. And the way I am, if I start reading some very insulting or aggressive comment, I'm going to get defensive and want to respond. And then I won't finish the next column in time for the deadline. And so I realized early on I can't read the comments. I'll never get this done. But I was curious what people were thinking. And so my trusty wife, Carol, did read the comments, and she would say things like, you know, most of the people really like it. There are a few pontificators, because there would always be a few other mathematicians who would say, you should have explained it like this. And then there would be a few people who really had substantive negative comments. And one of them that caught me was on this one. A person said that the series has now jumped the shark. And I have to admit, I didn't know what that meant. It didn't sound good. But maybe some of you know the phrase, jump the shark. Anyone want to explain that phrase? Yes, please. Yes, right, so, yes. Yes, so the explanation is that there was this old popular television show, Happy Days, which ran for many seasons and had character Fonzie, you may remember, in the black leather jacket and greased back hair. And the series, like any television series, started to get old after a while, and it was hard to think of new things to do to keep it fresh, and so the writers had the character Fonzie water skiing, I guess in his leather jacket, and jumping over a shark, and it has come to mean that when something that was once fresh starts to get stale and they do some absurd thing to freshen it up, you know it's near the end. Now, and so in my case, this was only column number 6. And a reader was saying I'd already jumped the shark at column 6. So I thought that was pretty alarming. And I guess the lesson, you know, that I want to end with, if I can jump back into my PowerPoint, is the lesson, the final lesson to leave you with, which is that you may want to listen to your trusted partner, wife, mother, friend, child. They can often give you a lot of insight into what's going to work. Okay, thanks very much. So people who do need to leave or want to leave, that's great. You're welcome to. And other people who would like to stay for a few minutes to have a discussion, that's fine with me. I think we may also take some questions from Twitter if any come in, but maybe not. We'll see. So let's just, do you want to stretch for a minute and then take a question? Or you have a question right now? There's a question. Okay, it's a comment. Sorry, let me repeat the comment. This is an amazing comment. The comment was that there's a plumbing convention for which faucet is hot, and that the left faucet is supposed to be the hot faucet, and I did it backwards. Wow. Thank you. I had no idea. I'm going to look at that in a bathtub the next time I see two faucets. You're really telling the truth? This is interesting. I have never heard this one before. The second question, yes? Okay, so this other comment was that when we did the proof for the area of a circle as being pi r squared, aren't we only getting the asymptote? That is sort of, we're approaching closer and closer to pi r squared. Is that your idea? But we're not really showing that the area of the circle itself is pi r squared, just that the area gets closer and closer to pi r squared. That's probably rigorously speaking true. I mean, the real proof that Archimedes gave, as some of you may know, uses a construction where you have polygons, like it could be a hexagon or something with more. Actually, Archimedes used a 6-sided shape, and then he went to 12 sides and 24 sides, and he kept doubling the number of sides like we did, except he didn't use sectors, things with curved sides. You know, we had a pie slice with a curve. He actually used just triangles and took more and more of them and showed that whether he that did the polygon on the outside of the circle or the inside of the circle, those two polygons approached the same area, which was approaching pi r squared. Though he didn't have the concept of limit the way we do today, but he had an equivalent method that the Greeks called method of exhaustion, which was, yes, it sounds funny, right? Like it's exhausting. It doesn't mean, it may mean exhausting for the person doing the proof, but what it really means is that the excess area not included in the polygons is being exhausted as you take more and more sides to the polygon. And so, okay, you could, I mean, yes, if you want to quibble, it's not really a totally rigorous proof. There's other aspects of it that aren't rigorous either, which I won't go into, but yes, it's not an ironclad proof. And it may be one reason why you don't see it in a lot of modern textbooks. A lot of math teachers are under the influence of a certain style of college math professor who wants every proof or every argument to be at the highest standard of rigor, which I think is a terrible idea in teaching. And actually, a great scientist and mathematician named Mark Kotz, who used to work at Los Alamos, had a good saying to this effect, that he said, in teaching, you should always tell the truth and nothing but the truth, but not the whole truth. And so I would say that's a case of this proof, that I've shown you the truth and nothing but the truth, but not the whole truth, and you've pointed out one aspect of the truth I've left out. And I think that's good, to let people realize that there can be gaps and then go on to a deeper level of understanding. But first they have to be ready to ask the question. And so this, I hope, has set you up to ask the right questions. Yes, please. Okay, here's a question from Twitter. Let's see, if I understand the question, it's what are the limits of explaining very complicated math to people? And that the idea, I'm not sure I get the thrust of the question, that somehow to be realistic, there are certain inherent limits and you shouldn't imagine you can explain anything to everybody. So what are those limits? I don't really accept the premise of the question. I think I would feel that if you got to know the person that you're working with and know what they know, you know, had a good sense of what it is they know or don't know or what they could handle, then you can, you know, then you might be able to gauge something that wouldn't be reasonable to explain. But I don't know any stock answer. I feel like it should be an intimate thing between a teacher and a student that requires sensitivity to what that person knows. Also, by the way, there are limits on what the teacher knows or is capable of explaining. And that's so, I mean, yes, there are limits, but I don't have any stock answer for what those limits are. They would be, I think, unfortunately, it's the answer, it depends. I don't know, I can't see how I could do any better than that on this question. Yes? So here the question was that there's a certain traditional curriculum that teaches topics in a certain fixed order that we, actually the order that David Shipley asked me to teach in, which is arithmetic first, then algebra, then geometry, then pre-calculus to calculus, and so on. Does it matter to use that specific order, or could other orders be better? Is that sort of the question? Or are there other orders imaginable? I would say absolutely there are other orders imaginable, and not only other orders, but other topics. That is, you may have seen some opinion pieces, not so recently, maybe a year ago, asking, is algebra necessary? There was one that got a lot of buzz by the political scientist Andrew Hacker that was in the New York Times. Is algebra necessary? And what he meant, I think, was that a lot of students suffer through algebra, and it's an obstacle for them. It prevents some of them from getting into colleges or other opportunities. They like keep repeatedly failing algebra. And so he wonders, why is that such an important thing? Like, in some subjects, we allow people to take certain basic subjects, and then the rest are electives. So you could say, could we have a model where we teach in the freshman year of high school some like overview of all of math? What's it all about? What are the great questions? Why are they important? And then for kids who seem like they're interested in it, they could elect, or it doesn't have to be the freshman year, maybe you do 2 years, and then in the third year, they can elect to take more or not. Why should it be for everybody all the way through? Also, there are other subjects that some people say are important to learn that we don't really teach, like you always hear probability and statistics. Another is mentioned is computing. Shouldn't modern students be learning how to solve math problems on the computer, not just the calculator, but really to program and visualize with computer graphics? And shouldn't we spend more time on that? So I don't want to take a stand on any of these, but I think it's a very interesting and important question that is open. I can't believe that our current system is optimal, that we've somehow, from a few hundred years ago, hit on the optimal way for the year 2014. It doesn't seem right. So I think it bears thinking about, and I'm not sure what the answer is, but and by the way, it would look pretty different from the Common Core, if you're interested in that controversy, that the Common Core doesn't ask that question. It talks about the standard topics, but going into more depth, and I mean, a lot of the goals of the Common Core seem admirable, to get people to think about the reasoning behind the work they're doing. The implementation, it's a different question. You know, is that really happening? I don't want to get into all that just now unless you want to, but. So the short answer is I don't believe that the current or standard curriculum has anything sacred about it. I think we ought to rethink it. Okay, yes, against the wall?
You know, in music and art,
So to summarize that question, the point was that if you overemphasize relevance, then you might end up with something that looks like the former Soviet approach to music or art. And there must be or ought to be a place for beauty or just interesting thinking without necessary practical relevance. And how do you make room for that kind of thing? Is that the question? Yeah. I'm not sure why there's any difficulty making room. Just don't overemphasize relevance. That is, like I was trying to say, relevance is one button that makes, that's if you want to justify math, relevance is one. Another is good career opportunities for you in the future, sort of tied into relevance. Another is very close to what you're saying about music, which is people don't ask the music teacher, why do I need to learn music? They ask the math teacher, why do I need to learn math? They don't ask the music teacher, why do I need to learn music? However, they might ask the music teacher, why do I need to be able to sight read? Or why do I need to be able to learn musical notation? Right? That might be analogous to what we put people through in math. That is, everyone knows that math or that music is beautiful and fun and, you know, enriches your life to appreciate music, to play music. So we don't have to justify music on purely aesthetic grounds. People don't talk about what's the usefulness of music. It's a silly, stupid question. That's, music is not great because it's useful. It's great because it's beautiful and uplifting and makes people happy and allows them to express themselves, et cetera, et cetera. And math has all of that too. So I would want to, and you know, do, and so do many teachers, say there's that whole aesthetic, useless aspect of math. That it's valuable not because it's useful, but because it makes your life better. So I, as long as there's room for that, along with the relevance, which I also care about, it's not just pure poetry or pure music, it's also goddamn useful. So I really think math is great that way, because it's art and it's science and it's sport and it's a language, you know, I mean, and it's community, it's a very social thing. So I think it's got a lot of the best elements of everything. Yes. I'm glad some of you like that. Maybe some of you don't buy it, but okay. Oh, wow, hard question. The question was, am I in favor of or against the use of calculators? Did you say in exams or just in general in school? Yeah, so you want to say at the level of learning the multiplication tables? Like, I may... Or another way to ask the question, and maybe forgive me if it's not the way you want to ask the question, is if it's okay to use calculators at some point, when is the right point? Like, is there a place where it's too early to be using calculators because you won't learn the basics and you'll use them as a crutch? I think that's how I would want to ask it. And, I haven't thought about it carefully. Instinctively, I feel like there's a place where it's too early, but I'm not sure where that is. I guess if I really just give a gut reaction, but I want to potentially amend it if I, a few minutes from now, change my mind, I think I would want everyone to memorize everything there is to know about addition, you know, the basics of adding the little numbers, and I want everyone to memorize the multiplication tables really fast so that, you know, there's no thinking. That should be rote. And I have ideas for how to make that fun. I mean, I've done it. I've tutored people. And there's no real obstacle to learning that, except you just have to practice it and make it fun and do it. So yeah, I wouldn't want calculators before multiplication. But what about long division? That's an interesting one. That's where I think it gets a little problematic, because having watched my kids go through long division and still not really be able to do it competently, do I really care? In my heart, I don't really care. So, but I can't give you a principled argument why I don't care. Because I know, like, in terms of extracting square roots, there used to be taught a method for doing that, and it's not taught, and I certainly don't care. So somewhere before square roots and somewhere after multiplication, those would be my bounds. That's just off the top of my head. I don't know. But yeah, do not teach multiplication with calculators. That would be a sin. One thing that comes up a lot now is many different ways of doing multiplication. Like, my kids learned a thing called lattice multiplication, which I was not taught, and which is pretty nifty. but I was not taught. I was taught a certain standard way, and I had trouble teaching them or helping them with lattice. And then they had to learn what's called old school, which is the way I was taught and maybe you were taught. And, you know, like you could ask, is it important for them to learn many different ways and why they're equivalent? Because that's happening now everywhere across America, that a lot of kids are suffering not just learning multiplication, but learning four different ways to think about multiplication. So they have four ways to screw up. And something about that seems wrong. I feel like I want them to just learn one way that they can do absolutely competently fast. And I don't care which way. But I don't think they need four ways. Later, they can think about why the four are equivalent. That seems like bad pedagogy to make them learn that at the beginning. Yes. It's a really interesting question about cross-cultural ways of teaching that in countries like India or which else? Did you mention other Asian countries, Singapore? Are they teaching differently given that these students do so much better on a lot of international standardized tests than our students do? Is it that there are different teaching methods? I wouldn't say that that's the important thing. I mean, they may be using slightly different methods, but I don't think that's really the issue. I think it's very cultural in America that people talk, and actually I'm guilty of it myself. I used the phrase like, are you a math person earlier tonight? Because I think we all in America know what that means, but some cultures are not willing to think that way. There are studies where you ask American parents what thing determines your child's success in math, and then you're given various options like genetics, natural talent, hard work, amount of time spent practicing, and stuff like that. And you know, the Japanese parents say hard work, and the American, I'm simplifying, but it would be much more common for an American parent to say hard work is not as important as natural talent. You either have a math head or you don't. And the Japanese parents don't say that. They say, everyone can do math, you have to work. So I sort of think if our culture just got a grip and said, of course everyone can do math, not everyone's gonna be a math genius. I do accept that there is such a thing as talent. I don't want to say it's just hard work or, you know, this fashionable term today, grit, that it's just grit. It's not just grit. There are people who are really smart. And I think that counts. But smart is not the only thing. Grit and hard work are really important. And we're too ready to give up. I just think that's it. And I don't know why. But we are like, you know, I do kind of know why. I shouldn't say this. I really think we're a very anti-intellectual country. Okay, I know that's not nice to say. I do think that. I'm showing, I don't know if this puts me on any place on the political spectrum. I am very far left, I'll tell you. But I think there are probably right-wing people who would say that too. That the part of our practical nature and our entrepreneurial nature and our inventor, you know, respect for inventors and money and stuff, that's a certain ingrained American tradition that I think works against being intellectual. And I think it hurts us in math. And not just math. I mean, I think it hurts us in a lot of subjects. Yes, please. What made me fall in love with math? Well, I know what experience it was. It was a life-changing experience. I always liked all of school. I still do like all the subjects. But math didn't stand out for me as anything special until a certain teacher said something remarkable one day in class, which was he told us, it was my pre-calculus teacher, Mr. Johnson, who said that there was a certain problem about triangles. It was not even part of what he was talking about. It wasn't pre-calculus, it was geometry. But he said here was a certain problem about triangles that he had been asking for years and no student had ever solved it. And he also said, and this was the remarkable part, that he didn't know how to solve it. And I never heard a teacher say something like that before. And it was so humble and so inspiring that here's a problem that the teacher doesn't know how to solve. And I thought that sounded very interesting. And so I started thinking about, I'll tell you if you want to know, what's the problem? The problem was if the angle bisectors of a triangle are congruent, then the triangle is isosceles. So in ordinary language, remember, angle bisector, that means the line that cuts the, you know, you have a triangle, and then there's a line that cuts an angle in half and then touches the other side. If the length of that angle bisector is the same as the length of that angle bisector, it's an isosceles triangle. These two angles down here are the same. So it sounds like other geometry problems, and I figured, whatever, I don't know why Mr. Johnson can't solve it, I'm going to try working on it. And I had always been able to solve every other geometry problem that they asked, so why not this one? So I worked on it, and I couldn't do it. And I worked on it for days and days. And, you know, and I stopped, like, in French class when they're doing the plus que parfait. I was thinking about the angle bisectors. And same thing playing basketball. Guys would throw the ball to me. I was always a bad player to begin with, but I was even worse. Anyway, so I just found that I couldn't stop thinking about this triangle problem. And I would say I spent about half a year thinking about it for the fun of it, and partly for the irritation of it, that it was just bugging me, like, because I would get things that were really close to working, and then they wouldn't work. And I didn't feel like giving up. I just wanted to keep thinking about it. And I realize now that that's research. I mean, it's not like this was a new problem. It turns out this is a famous problem called the Steiner-Lemus theorem. But Mr. Johnson didn't know that, and I didn't know that. For us, it was this problem at the edge of knowledge. And I was doing research on it for the pure pleasure and irritation of it. And eventually, I got something that I thought was a proof. I say it that way because the proof was wrong. But I thought it was a proof. I showed it to him. He checked it very carefully. He thought it was right. He wrote a nice comment to the headmaster of the school. Steven has real talent. I was all proud of myself. But more than that, I felt so exhilarated from this whole process of thinking about it and solving it, that I wanted to do it again. I wanted another problem like that. And so I just started making up problems that I didn't know the answer to, and just keeping a little notebook, and most of them were too hard and I couldn't do them, but some I could do. And anyway, so that was it. It was a turning point because of a teacher. All right, so keep in mind how important they are. You hear so much bad-mouthing about teachers nowadays that they can really change people's lives and do all the time, every day. Yes? Let's see, if I understand the question, you're saying, how do we know, back with that circle question, that the area formula is the same for all size circles? Yeah, well, it's a very good question. One way you could approach it is you could think about it the way Archimedes did, where you draw the picture inside. I don't have a blackboard, but if you would draw inside the circle, you know, something like a square that just touches, or, you know, this construction where you have polygons inside. So it's easy to check that for the polygons inside and outside, the circumscribed, or inscribed and circumscribed polygons, that this property is true, that the area of those doesn't depend. I mean, the formula for the area of those is the same formula, whether it's a small or a big circle. So that's one argument, that if it's true for the polygons, for big and small, in the limit, it will also be true for the circles. I don't know, I hope that gives you the flavor. Yes? The question was that students can be doing very well on all kinds of questions in their math classes that are calculational problems, but then when it's a word problem where you have English combined with math and how to translate the English into math in the right way, those seem to be an extra level of difficulty, and how to help students master such word problems. I agree with you. Those are an extra notch of sophistication above, and so it's very alarming to me that my own daughters, in their curriculum, only spent like a day or two on word problems as if it were just one more topic. And it's not. It's really conceptually at a whole different level, and it requires, I would say, several weeks of of thinking, and not just being taught recipes, like with the bathtub problem. Some books I see say, this is a problem of, they have some word for it, like rates. This is a rates problem, or a work problem, or some, and I understand why they're doing it. They try to make everything into a cookbook with a recipe for this type of thing, because I'm sad to say it, the teacher doesn't really know how to think about the problem, and you make it into a recipe so the teacher can understand it, and then the students can parrot it back, and no real learning is happening. That's not going to work. You really need teachers who understand math. We have to encourage our good math people to go into teaching. It's a very noble profession. Please join us. And it's also fun. And okay, but so yeah, we want the right people teaching, but then these are very hard problems, and you need a teacher who can help the student think about it. I don't know how else to do it. The other thing is, the student needs a lot of practice and a lot of chance to make mistakes and a safe environment where you're not taught that math has a right and a wrong. Of course it does. But you should be taught that asking a good question is really valuable, or making a really instructive mistake. You know, you should get points for that so that the students feel safer about, feel they're in a safer place to really explore math. The way I did, like when I'm talking about the triangle problem, I didn't have any timer that said I had to solve it. I was able to explore it for 6 months. And now I know you can't have everyone doing that for 6 months. But anyway, I don't know. Am I answering your question? I mean, it's a hard thing what you're asking. Word problems are really hard. And by the way, they're the beginning of applied mathematics. That's my subject, is looking at something in the world, often phrased in English or often in a scientific description, and then putting the math into it, and then trying to solve it with math, and then connect it back to the real world. That's a really beautiful and important art form in math, and a scientifically important one. So I would love to see us do better on word problems, but they're hard. Yes? Oh, okay, last question? Okay, so I pointed to this gentleman. You're the last question. This is a very interesting question. Yes, so the question is that we learn to count, we're taught to count in base 10, right? We have 10 fingers. We use the so-called decimal system, which means 10. And that's an accident of our biology, that we happen to have 10 fingers. So, you know, is there any mathematical reason why we should be using base 10? And if not, is there a better base? And first, just to mention one interesting thing that I learned while writing The Joy of X, that some parts of the world do not use base 10. You may know this, that in parts of Central Asia, like I take it to be around where, say, like Kazakhstan is now, base 12 is very common and is still used. And the reason, and also you see base 12 in other parts of that part of Asia, because, you know, as you may know, that the Babylonians used a lot of base 12 and then later base 60. And base 60 hangs on in things like 60 minutes to an hour, 60 seconds to a minute, 360 degrees, you know, 6 times 60. All the 60s and all the 12s, 12 months in a year, a lot of the 12 hours, you know, in a half a day. These 12s and 60s are holdovers from the Babylonians. Now you could ask, what's going on with 12? Well, there's 12 on your hand too. You think that this is 10, this is the only thing. Here's 12, watch. You take your thumb and use it to count with, and count the little flanges on your finger. Each finger has three of them. Okay, so I go like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Okay, that's base 12 on your hand. And you count like that, and then you keep track of 1, 12, 2, 12s, 3, 12s, and you have 5, 12s, that's base 60. And so this knuckle counting is common still in some tribes in Central Asia, and it explains all the 60s that we still have in our language and in our units. So, okay, so would base 12 be better than base 10? In some ways, it is better. The Babylonians had it right, because 12 is a much better number than 10. It's divisible by 1, 2, 3, 4. And 12 is good. Base 12 might be better. But, you know, I guess where you're really going with this is that base 2 is the best. you know, and that's why computers are using base 2 in binary arithmetic. I don't know. I'm not sure what the best is, but base 2 has a lot to say for it. And if you're going to do something with human anatomy, I think base 12 might be better in some ways. Okay, thanks a lot, everybody.